It's good to see you. It's week one of TED Talks. If you are not aware, there was a TV show that kind of took the nation by storm over the last couple of years. It's called Ted Lasso. It's on Apple TV, and some of you are thinking, what's an Apple TV? And it's fine. You can Google it later and find out. But it's a show that was nominated for 40 Emmys this year, and it won 11 of them. And so lots of people have found it helpful. In fact, a number of articles came out in secular publications comparing Ted Lasso to Jesus, because Ted Lasso is such a loving guy and always looking for the best in people and always trying to help other people out. And so people thought, well, Ted's a lot like Jesus. And we think that Ted displays a lot of the kind of traits that a follower of Jesus should have. You know, the fruits of the Spirit, as we say, as the New Testament teaches us, are love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And Ted Lasso displays a lot of those things. But here's the thing. If you compare Ted Lasso to Jesus, and this will shock you, Ted Lasso doesn't quite measure up. he's really good. He's really good, but he doesn't go nearly far enough. And so we thought, what would it be like to take a few weeks and talk about the good aspects of Ted Lasso, some of that the culture is like, yes, that looks good, we're clinging on to that, but also like see how does Jesus take them farther? So I want to start today by showing you a little bit of a clip. This is from the last episode of season one of Ted Lasso. It does not give away like the whole plot of the season or anything, so if you haven't watched it yet, fair warning, by the way, this is not a show that we wholeheartedly endorse every piece of, right? There's some language in it and stuff that we don't usually use from the platform here, but it's got some really good messages in it. And so in this particular episode, the soccer team has to win this game or they get what's called relegated. They get sent down to a worse league. So if you're not familiar with soccer in the UK, if your team is bad enough for long enough, you can actually be relegated down to a worse league. Can you imagine if like that happened here in the United States? The Clippers many years ago, right, would have ended up in a totally different league, and the Lakers would have ended up in one after this season. So that's like sports owners would not have that here, but that's how it works over there. So there's a lot of pressure on this last game, but they are playing a really, really good team, and they don't think probably that there's any way that they can win. So in this first clip, Ted Lasso, the coach who used to be an American football coach but is now coaching soccer, something he knows nothing about in Europe, is kind of finding out that other people don't really think that they're going to be able to pull it out. Here's the clip.
Hey, how you doing, fellas?
We just wanted to say thanks.
Yeah, we know you did your best.
You act like we lost the game already, yeah? Why don't you have a little hope?
Haven't you lived here long enough to realize?
It's the hope that kills you.
Why don't you text Nate? We got a little work to do tonight, huh?
Okay, come on. We got this. Look, we win, we're in. Okay?
There is a scenario where Crystal Palace beat Norwich by 6 goals and we avoid relegation with just a tie.
No. Nope, sorry. Uh-uh. No, I hate ties, Nate. How many times I gotta tell you that? They ain't natural, all right? If God wanted games to end in a tie, she wouldn't have invented numbers, all right? Come on, guys, let's fire up. Let's go. Hey, for the love of Meghan Markle, do not blow that whistle again, Nate. I swear, I got neighbors upstairs and they will just start stomping away, okay? Come on, tell me how we beat Manchester City.
We cannot beat Manchester City.
Dang it, Nate! That is not what I want to hear from my assistant coach on his first day.
It is hopeless.
Oh, I'm sorry, it's hopeless?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Quick question. Are those the only clothes you own?
Not this? No, I've got 3 of these.
That ring a bell, Nate? That ring a very large bell in your head?
You have that hanging in your home.
I got a ton of these hanging up in here. This one's from the bathroom mirror. It's the first thing I see every morning, and it's the last thing I see at night when I rationalize being too tired to floss.
Believe. In fact, this whole show really is centered around this idea that you can believe. Believe in yourself, believe in better outcomes. Belief is a good thing. In fact, we'll watch a clip toward the end today that where he really props up belief as being very, very important, which may beg the question, right? Like, why do we believe what we believe? Like, if your assistant coach doesn't think that there is any way in the world you can possibly beat this soccer team, like, how do you get them to actually shift that belief? Why did he arrive at that belief in the first place, and how might he reconsider it? Why do we believe what we believe? The thing is, like, if someone just tells you to believe something different, we usually don't find that very persuasive. I can tell you all I want to believe that the sky is green, but you're not going to just change your belief suddenly that the sky is green. Or I can tell you all I want that you should believe that all elephants are pink, but you're not going to suddenly start believing that all elephants are pink. I can tell you all I want to believe that the Lakers are a good team this season. You're not going to believe that unless you are crazy, okay? So I can tell you to believe these things, but you won't believe these things. Why is that? Why is it that we believe what we believe, and how do our beliefs change? This morning, we're going to spend all of our focus on one story in the book of John in chapter number 3 around Jesus and his interaction with a Pharisee, a religious teacher of his day named Nicodemus. So we're going to start in John chapter 3 and verse number 1, and a lot is going to come up about belief as we look through this passage. So John chapter 3, starting with verse number 1, and we read this. There was a man named Nicodemus, a Jewish religious leader who was a Pharisee. After dark one evening, he came to speak with Jesus. "Rabbi," he said, "we all know that God has sent you to teach us. Your miraculous signs are evidence that God is with you." So a number of things that are maybe helpful to know about Nicodemus. First of all, he hasn't actually asked Jesus a question in this account. We're not sure exactly what he came to find out, but we do know that this man was very religious, and he was a teacher. He was very well known as a teacher and very knowledgeable as a teacher. And yet he's coming to Jesus to find out something else, something he doesn't know, or a new way of doing things. He's curious about Jesus, and he knows that Jesus has done these miracles, these signs, he believes. And so Jesus must have some kind of direct connection or pathway to the Father, to God, that he does not have. So he comes seeking him. In other words, Nicodemus is willing to re-examine his beliefs. And when is it that we are willing to re-examine our beliefs? See, our beliefs function as a sense-making device of the world. When we have a belief about the way something works, it helps us save, like, brain power on trying to figure every little thing out, right? When we have a belief that, okay, if I drop something, it's going to fall to the ground, right? And whether you know, nowadays we know that that's gravity, but before they even knew that, there was a consistent belief that, like, that's how the world operates. When I drop something, something falls to the ground. And so then we don't have to go guessing every time we drop something as to whether it's going to fall to the ground or shoot up to the sky. No, the belief is that, no, it will fall to the ground because I've seen the pattern enough at this point that that is what happens, right? So we start making, we start to develop beliefs over the course of our life as we see things in action, as people tell us how the world works, as we can start to make sense of the world through a particular lens or set of beliefs. You know, and we would like to think, many of us would like to think, that we only believe that which is obviously true, which is adorable if we can trick ourselves into thinking that. But lots of us, all of us, have some amount of beliefs that we can't prove. I can't prove, for instance, that my wife loves me. I can't prove that. She says she does. She's still married to me after 20 years. She still puts up with my stuff, right? Right? She does all those things. But I can't prove that she loves me. It's a belief that I hold. And I believe I hold it on evidence, but I can't prove it. And that's one tiny example. I also can't prove that my six-year-old loves me, and I have much less evidence that he does than my wife does, okay? Like, so, but I believe that he does. It's a belief that I have. Those are tiny examples, and yet you could probably think of dozens and dozens more of things that you believe to be true that you can't actually prove. When then are you willing, like Nicodemus is, to re-examine your beliefs? And here's why it happens. Your beliefs change when holding on to them becomes more painful than letting go. Your beliefs change when holding on to them becomes more painful than letting go. Okay, so for instance, you might believe that someone loves you until the evidence starts to stack up that they don't. And you can continue to hold on to that belief and just continue to get hurt by them over and over and over and over again. Or at some point, you can call it what it is. Actually, they're not treating me in a loving way at all. I don't actually think that they love me. And that is a hard, like, that is painful to name, but then you can perhaps move into a healthier, better existence. Our beliefs change. Our beliefs change when holding on to them becomes more painful than letting go. So Nicodemus comes to Jesus, and he's willing to re-examine his beliefs, and he's willing to do this. In some way, he's willing to seek God. And I, I've talked to, I've been pastoring for over 20 years now, and lots of conversations. And I know this, that for many Americans, they are not interested in seeking God. Like, that is not high on the agenda list. That's not something that they've been handed as a value. It may or may not be something that was handed to you as a value in your home growing up. Like, seeking God may have been strange. I actually talked to a friend of mine this week that one of their family, they have five family values that they do. And one of their family values is we put God first. And he was sitting down with his family this week, and they've talked about these values in the past, but all of his kids are a little bit older now. They're like preteen to teens. And they sat down and they were like, here's our five values. And his kids were like, yeah, Dad, that we put God first one, what does that even mean? So they had to talk through that, right? And work through that and figure out what that means. So some of us are handed that as kids, but lots of us aren't. And if we aren't, most people aren't walking through their life on a God quest. They're walking through their lives on a happiness quest. Most people who live in the United States are looking for happiness. That's what they want. And if God can get me there, then I might examine God, but you'd have to really convince me that that's possible. So when is it that we actually seek God? Here's two ways. And I got these from Tim Keller, who I think is very helpful. He says this. Number one, we seek God when we realize we can't help ourselves. We seek God when we realize we can't help ourselves. Here's what I mean by that. All of us have some significant flaws within us that we try to downplay on a regular basis. But at some point in our life, we will reach a place where that flaw becomes really obvious and we recognize, like on our own, we can't deal with it, right? Some of you really struggle with imposter syndrome. You walk through life, you walk through your job all the time feeling like you're actually not that good at it, you're actually not sure how you got to the place you were, and someday someone's going to find you out. And some of you just walk through life like that. You've walked through parenting like that. You're like, I don't actually know how to do this. Like, you just feel all the time like you're right on the cusp of dropping everything, dropping all the balls, and everybody seeing just what an imposter you are. That's what some of you are struggling with. Some of you are struggling with just kind of low-grade anger all the time. You just find you've been disappointed a number of times in your life by people who you were close to, people you loved. You've been disappointed by systems and managers, businesses, possibly the government, corporations, big tech. You've been disappointed by any number of things. You could probably make a whole list, and you probably have some really fair stories of ways that you've been sincerely let down by people or corporations or entities. But what it's left you with is this kind of like low-grade anger all the time. It's just below the surface, and you act like it's not a big deal, but the people closest to you, they see it flare up sometimes, and it's hard on them, right? Some of you struggle with seeing things through. Like, you're happy to be there for the beginning, and you're happy to be there while things are going pretty well, but once things get really hard, your first inclination is to eject or to do something else. Or to get out of it, to run away from that. And maybe it's because you struggle with the conflict, the person-to-person conflict, or maybe it's just that you struggle, you don't like to feel anything but happiness and joy and good vibes all the time. And so when something's not that, instead of working through it, your tendency is to run away. Right? So I can name a bunch of other stuff, but all of us have some things that we know are flaws within us, within our character, things that actually have had a negative impact on the way that we've interacted with the people around us and the way that we've behaved and lived in the world. And for many of us, we downplay those for much of our life, and we try to pretend that they're not a big deal, but then something happens that's out of our control. As meticulously as we may plan, we run into a financial problem, or the market shift, and the thing happens that we never saw coming, or we get let go and we didn't see that coming, or they walk away from us, or they betray us, or these things that we can control, and then there's lots of things that we can't, and at some point in our life, the things that we can't will come crashing into our world. And when they do, oftentimes the things that, the flaws that we've tried to downplay for so long will come bursting to the surface. And it will feel like at that moment that we actually don't have control of this stuff. And if we're honest with ourselves, we'll realize at that moment that we never did. See, for many of us, we have this like inherent, innate belief that we can figure it out, we can help ourselves, we can pull ourselves up by our own bootstraps, we can get it done. And it's actually only when we start to realize that we can't, that we might be willing to seek God. a second reason we seek God. We seek God when we realize the world can't help us. We seek God when we realize the world can't help us. It's one thing to say that I can't help myself or that I need somebody else to help me. It's another to say, like, actually, there's not help to be found in the world around me. So let's look at Nicodemus for just a moment, like his biography, his background, because I think it'll help all of us see with fairly clear eyes some of the things that maybe we pretend are true as well. Nicodemus, first of all, he had connections. He was a member of the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin was like the Supreme Court of Israel. It was the Supreme Court of the Jewish people in the first century. There were 70 men and one high priest that made up the Sanhedrin. And so they really dictated the law for those that they could. Now, in Roman times, right, in the first century, Rome is overseeing everything. So they couldn't dictate all laws, but they had a sliver for sure that was underneath their control. Rome had continued the policies that their predecessor had made, which was to give these different religious groups, the Jewish people being one of them, enough autonomy in the culture so that they felt like they had some control over their lives. It made them more docile, more willing to not rise up against the empire is what they believed. So the Sanhedrin, we don't know exactly what it looked like, but it would have looked something like this. Whenever there was someone who was brought before the Sanhedrin, accused or on trial, there would have been, you know, roughly 35 people probably on each side, and then the high priest in the center. And they met pretty much every day of the year, aside from like feast days and festivals. They met all the time. And Nicodemus is a part of this. He's a part of this group of people. So he has lots of connections within the Sanhedrin. Because of his position, because of his status, he would have had access to some of the most powerful people in the land. And for Nicodemus, he was probably convinced at some point in his life that his connections could go a long way toward helping him, as many of us are. You know, we feel like if we have powerful connections or we know really smart people, or if we could call that favor and if we had to, we feel like, oh, we'll probably be good. If I can't handle it, I know someone who can. Nicodemus also had money. Now, we don't know exactly how much, but it appears to be quite a lot. Toward the end of the book of John, we get to actually see Nicodemus' trajectory. And after this first encounter with Jesus, he pops up a couple of other times, once during the trial of Jesus and once after Jesus dies. After Jesus dies, Nicodemus shows up with 100 pounds of myrrh and aloes to help bury his body. This was enough myrrh and aloes to be like a royal burial. I mean, this cost a lot of money. So when Nicodemus comes to Jesus in John chapter 3, we don't actually know much about his wealth at this point in the story, but we find out later he actually has quite a bit of money. And yet, even though he has this money, he seems to have decided that there is something that Jesus might have access to or might know that might be more helpful than the stuff that he has. So he has connections, he has money, and then finally he has power. He's a Pharisee, which was a highly influential group of Jewish leaders. And what they taught oftentimes was considered by the people to be like the understanding or the interpretation of their Hebrew scriptures. And he's known. Jesus talks to him in just a few verses and calls him a great teacher. Like, he's a well-known teacher. So this guy has connections. He has money. He has power. And for lots of us, we convince ourselves, if we have these things, or we can get these things, or we can establish these things, well, then even if I can't help myself, at least the world can help me. And when we start to seek God is when we start to realize that actually the world can't help us either. We can't help ourselves, and the world can't help us either. I heard a pastor a few weeks ago who was talking about the fact that they sat in on a psychiatric course at a local college, because they had a famous psychiatrist who was coming and speaking to the local mental health group of professionals there. And they just wanted to see, like, how the conversation went. And so toward the end, they opened it up for some questions, and they were able to give some specifics of their cases, like anonymized, but some specifics of their cases that they had questions about or wanted to know, like, how would you handle this? How should this be handled? And one of the people talked about the fact that they had a patient who realized that a lot of the reasons that they were so short-tempered and that they got angry with other people so quickly is because of anger that they had towards their father and the abuse that they had experienced at the hand of their father when they were growing up. And he said, so what he's realizing is that he's going to have to forgive his father. He's like, so it's taken us months to kind of get to this place where he's been able to identify, like, this is the problem. He's like, but now he's got to forgive his father. He's like, so what advice would you give him for forgiving his father? And this very famous psychiatrist said, I would wish him a lot of luck. And the guy said, okay, but that doesn't seem like great advice. So, like, what else would you say? How should he go about it? And he said, listen, you have followed the science to trace back, right, the origin of the anger. Like, that's what you can do. But now you're entering into the realm of forgiveness, something we'll talk about in a couple weeks, by the way. He said, but now you're entering the realm of forgiveness. And forgiveness, now you're talking about, like, ethics and issues of right and wrong and faith. And he was like, this goes beyond what the psychiatry can do, what the field can do. And then he said this statement, and this was the killer. He said, if you're looking for changed hearts, you're in the wrong profession. Right? It's the idea that we can assess the problem, but when it's something like that, we're not actually trying to fix it in the way that it might best need to be fixed. There are limits to the science around this, and at some point you're in the realm of like faith or belief or ethics or morals or right or wrong. And so when we get to that point, psychiatry as a science doesn't have as much to say about it. So there's this place you can get where you start to realize, like, I can't help myself. And then you start to realize, like, well, the world can't help me either. And when you get to that place, then you might be ready, as Nicodemus seems to be ready, to explore the possibility that you need to re-examine your beliefs. So Nicodemus comes to him. Jesus replies this to him. He says, I tell you the truth. Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. I like this response because it's not what he was expecting. In fact, Nicodemus says this. What do you mean, he exclaimed Nicodemus. How can an old man go back into his mother's womb and be born again? By the way, you're welcome. I don't have any images to show what that would look like. Okay, so just decided to cut that right out. He's like, wait, that doesn't make any sense. Nicodemus basically feels like this, right? I'm a Jewish teacher of the law. I've been following God my whole life. I've been walking in this way, and I come to you, and I want to know some more about how to get toward the kingdom. And my thinking is, right, I'm almost there. Like, what's the last step? What's the last thing I need to do? And Jesus essentially says, everything you've done is all wrong. You got to start all over, be born again, do it all over again. Okay, that doesn't seem fair. That's not what I wanted to know. My friends, Josh and Kristen, I got married. They were living in Missouri, but they wanted to have their wedding in San Diego. And so a number of years ago, they flew out to San Diego, and my wife and I flew out, and our son Jack was like a year old at the time, so baby on a plane, that was fun. And we got out here, and they did a beautiful ceremony. And they had a local pastor from the San Diego area actually do the wedding, and he signed the wedding certificate, and they flew back right to Missouri, and they went to file it. And they got, a few weeks later after they filed it, they got like a rejection letter in the mail saying that their wedding wasn't real because the pastor that they got it wasn't a Missouri citizen. It had to be someone from Missouri if it's going to be a Missouri certificate. And so her and Josh, Chris and Josh, they went to the registry office or whatever, and they were like, are you sure? Is this really, like, we're not actually married? To this point, they've been, you know, living together for the last several weeks as if they were a married couple, and they're like, no, you're not married. And she said, I feel so dirty. And so she's like, so what do we have to do? We just have to get, like, a different pastor to come and sign it here in the courthouse. She's like, no, you have to redo the whole wedding. What? Yeah, like, witnesses need to be there. Like, you need to use a local minister to redo the whole wedding. So they redid the whole wedding. And it was much smaller, obviously, and it was just a handful of friends. But, you know, my friend Josh was insistent that they have cake, and so they did that, because why wouldn't you? And so they redid the whole thing. But even to a larger extent, this is kind of the answer that Nicodemus gets, right? Like, I just want to know, like, what's the next thing, right? You seem to have a connection. Like, what do I do? I'm willing to re-examine. I'm willing to go the last step. And Jesus says, actually, you got to do the whole thing over again. What's that? The whole thing? Yeah, your whole life. You have to be born again. Well, that doesn't make any sense, Nicodemus says. I'm an old man. I'm going to crawl back up into my mother's womb. No. Well, that doesn't make sense. So Jesus goes on and explains. Jesus replied, I assure you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. Now, this phrase, kingdom of God, by the way, we could spend a whole series on easily. But for today, let's just say that essentially what Jesus is saying is no one can live in the realm of God forever with God, right? Like, that's like into eternity. It starts now, but into eternity. No one can do that without being born of water and the Spirit. Humans can reproduce only human life, but the Holy Spirit gives birth to spiritual life. So don't be surprised when I say you must be born again. Now, look, if Nicodemus was looking for answers, it's not clear that this helped him any more than the last thing Jesus said. Even this is a fairly confusing thing to say. What does it mean to be born of water and of spirit. And what Jesus is pointing to, it seems to be, and scholars go back and forth and disagree about this, but John the Baptist, who had come before Jesus, had been baptizing people out in the wilderness. And he was essentially saying, you need to clean yourself up because the Messiah that God is sending is about to be here. People used to be baptized to be purified. It was to be cleaned, sacramentally clean. And so they could do that like in the city, at the temple, like that was a place that you could do that. But John goes outside of the city, away from the temple, and he's doing it out in the middle of the wilderness. And in doing so, what he's saying is like, it's time to be baptized, to be washed, because the Messiah is coming. And you don't have to do it in the temple or in the city, because God doesn't just exist in the temple or in the city. God is everywhere. And so he's doing a new thing, so we're going to do it outside of the city. And so this almost certainly would have been on Nicodemus' mind. In fact, just later on in this chapter, and we're going to look at this in a few weeks, later on in this chapter, John the Baptist is going to come back up. We just left him a few verses before this. And so certainly it seems like probably one of the things that Jesus had in mind is this kind of baptism, baptized by water, right? You have to be baptized by water, born of water and of the Spirit. There is something that, and Jesus is going to talk about this more later, but there is something that happens when we choose to believe and put our trust in God, that the Spirit of God actually baptizes us as well, falls upon us, changes us, transforms us. It takes that belief, it takes that acceptance of God's free gift that he's going to get to in just a moment. But that's what it takes. That's how you have to be reborn. It has nothing to do with wombs. It has everything to do with the work of the Spirit in the world and the belief in what God has done for you. He goes on, humans can reproduce only human life, but the Holy Spirit gives birth to spiritual life. So don't be surprised when I say you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it wants. Just as you can hear the wind, but can't tell where it comes from or where it is going, so you can't explain how people are born of the Spirit. In other words, he says, you have to be born of the Spirit. And if Nicodemus' next question was, explain that to me, Jesus says, I can't. I just know it's real. And Nicodemus, it's what you need. And it's what we need too. So Nicodemus asks, well, how are these things possible? And Jesus replies, you're a respected teacher and you don't understand these things? Boy, wouldn't that feel bad, by the way? You're talking to Jesus, you're like, explain that to me. And he was like, you don't get it, idiot. Like, it's how it would feel, right? He didn't actually use the word, but it's like, you're a respected Jewish teacher, and yet you don't understand these things? I assure you, we tell you what we know and have seen, and yet you won't believe our testimony. Here's what I think Jesus is pointing to. It took some study on this, by the way, because this is a peculiar passage. But Jesus is talking about rebirth and recreation and being made new by the Spirit. He's talking about a whole new way of living. And Nicodemus is like, I don't understand that. That doesn't make any sense to me. I think what Jesus is saying is like, you're a respected Jewish teacher. Don't you know that God consistently works miracles of creation and recreation? Like, he does it all the time. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's how the first passage of the Hebrew scripture starts. And certainly, this Jewish teacher would have known that. John begins his gospel, the gospel we're looking at right now. John begins his gospel with, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. And so it starts off right away with echoes of that creation story. God is a God of creation and recreation. We see him over and over again doing that in the Hebrew scriptures. And so Jesus is just saying, like, hey, the same pattern that you see God doing over and over in the Hebrew scriptures is still at work today. God creates, he recreates, he saves. Like, that's what you need to know, Nicodemus. But if you don't believe me when I tell you about earthly things, how can you possibly believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ever gone to heaven and returned, but the Son of Man has come down from heaven. In other words, there is no man, no woman that has ever left here and gone to the realm of heaven and come back to say what they've seen. He's saying, but I came from the heavenly realm. I was there. He's making a very exclusive claim there. It's just me. If you want to understand the truth, if you want to know what to believe, you should listen to me. You should listen to me because I, the Son of Man, is how he refers to himself, but the Son of Man has come down from heaven. Then he goes on. And as Moses lifted up the bronze snake on a pole in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him will have eternal life. This is a weird passage, and you have to know something from the Hebrew Scriptures, from the book of Numbers, to understand what the deal is. So, in the book of Numbers, there is this story, and this is a painting of it, and it was, you know, one of those European paintings, and it's weird, but this is the best one I could find, okay? So it probably didn't look like this at all. I don't know why they're all European. Okay, so in the book of Numbers, there's a story where the people of God disobey God, and after they disobey God, poisonous snakes start to come into the camp, and they start to bite them. And so this bronze snake is crafted, and it's put up so that people can look at it. And if they're bitten by a snake, if they'll look at the bronze snake that Moses crafted, then they won't die from their snake bites. It's a weird story. But that's the story. And what's interesting, too, is like over time, this bronze snake then got carried around with Israel, and eventually it became an idol for them. They started to worship the bronze snake. The bronze snake was given to them by God as a mechanism for their salvation that day. And eventually they started to worship the mechanism for their salvation instead of worshiping the God who provided it. So Jesus he's referencing this story. He's saying, like, look, just as the Israelites had to look up at the bronze snake in order to see salvation, so they'll have to look at the Son of Man when he is lifted up. And the Son of Man was lifted up. You know, a lot of times in evangelical churches, they don't really talk about, like, we don't have crucifixes with Jesus on them, because the whole thing is that, like, well, yeah, but Jesus isn't on the cross anymore. He died, but he rose from the dead. That's not where he is. But in the Catholic tradition, many times they will have Jesus on the cross, and it's not because they don't believe that Jesus left the cross and rose from the dead. It's because one of the things that they want to remind themselves of is that just as we suffer, Jesus suffered too. It's a way of looking at the cross and recognizing how Jesus completely descended into our reality in order to change it and to shift it. And so Jesus is saying to Nicodemus, like, just as the ancient Israelites had to look at that bronze snake in order to find their salvation, you will need to look at the Son of Man when he is lifted high. Why? Because the bronze snake, right, was a statue of the snakes that were biting them and poisoning them. And so it seems weird or peculiar that Jesus would, in a similar way, be lifted up. Jesus was not biting us and poisoning us, okay? So why is he the one raised up on the stick? What is the similarity there? Scholar N.T. Wright says this about this passage. What he is saying is that the evil, which was and is in the world, deep-rooted within us all, was somehow allowed to take out its full force on Jesus. Right? We talked earlier about those flaws that we have, that we often try to downplay, but that then rise up. Those flaws, like one of the biblical ways of talking about that is to call that sin. It's the way that we break relationship, that we break things in the world. It's our human propensity to make a mess of things. It's also idolatry, when we make good things ultimate things, right? Money can be a good thing, but if you make it an ultimate thing, it takes the place of God, the very one who created you, and it leads to a warped life. Success can be a good thing. It can provide all kinds of enjoyment and fulfillment. But if you make success a good thing into an ultimate thing, it will take the place of God and it will warp the way that you live your life. Marriage and family are good things. They can be very good things. But if you make those things ultimate things, they take the place of God and they warp the way that you see and live your life. We can go on and on and on. But the sin in our life, the idols that we have, the ways that we break relationship, the ways that we have a human propensity to make a mess of things, Jesus took all of that on the cross. When he was lifted up, the things that were poisoning us, right, they weren't snakes, they were our sins. And that's what Jesus places on himself. So in a way, right, it's much more metaphorical than the snake was. You have to use your imagination to understand, like, what's happening there, but it's also literal as well. Like, when we don't just see Jesus, we also see the sin that we commit, the things that drag us down, the flaws in us that he was willing to take on himself. So we're not just seeing Jesus, we are seeing our own sin when we look up at that, when we look up at that cross, when we look up at that post, when he is lifted up, and therefore, we are seeing the thing that's poisoning us. It's not Jesus, but Jesus takes the thing that is poisoning us and he puts it on his shoulders. When we look at Jesus hanging on the cross, what we are looking at is the result of the evil in which we are all stuck. And we are seeing what God has done about it. That's why Jesus uses the metaphor of the snakes and him being lifted up. And then what comes next is one of the most famous passages in all of the New Testament. In fact, at many football games, you'll see people holding signs, John 3:16, right? And so many of us have heard this so many times that it's lost meaning for us, but it comes here in this conversation with Nicodemus. And this is what Jesus says to him. For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. And God sent his son into the world, not to judge the world, but to save the world through him. He wasn't brought here to judge, but to save, if you believe. There is no judgment against anyone who believes in him. But anyone who does not believe in him has already been judged for not believing in God's one and only son. And the judgment is based on this fact. God's light came into the world, but people love the darkness more than the light, for their actions were evil. What Jesus essentially is saying here is, look, you can't do it. The world can't do it. Only God can do it. And the way that God has chosen to do it is to send his one and only son. His one and only son that will take all of the darkness and sin and brokenness and flaws of you and take it on his own shoulders and nail it to a cross and allow it to work its way through him. And then it's going to kill him. It's on that third day when he rises from the dead that he actually defeats all of that junk from your life that was placed on him. And it's done away with. And all you have to do is believe that. It's hard for us to trust that. It's hard for us to believe that it's that simple, that it's that good. He goes on, all who do evil hate the light and refuse to go near it for fear that their sins will be exposed. But those who do what is right come to the light so others can see that they are doing what God wants. So what Jesus is saying is, like, this is the message. This is the gospel. This is what it means to reconnect with God. It's to believe that his son came and made a way for you to connect with him who is perfect. You weren't perfect. You walked away. You made good things, ultimate things, but God wanted to fix all that. And so he sent his son to take all that upon himself, to die and to rise from the dead so that it would be ultimately defeated. And all you have to do is believe. But belief's a tricky thing. We can't always help what we believe. One final quick clip. When Ted gathers the soccer team together before this very big, monumental, pivotal game, he gives them a talk about belief.
All right now, fellas, hey, let's focus up, huh? So I've been hearing this phrase y'all got over here that I ain't too crazy about. It's the hope that kills you. Y'all know that?
Yeah.
I disagree, you know? I think it's the lack of hope that comes and gets you. See, I believe in hope. I believe in belief. Now, where I'm from, we got a saying too. Yeah? Question, actually. Do you believe in miracles? Now, I don't need y'all to answer that question for me. But I do want you to answer that question for yourselves. Right now. Do you believe in miracles? And if you do, then I want y'all to circle up with me right now. Come on, let's go. Get them in here.
If only belief were that easy. In 1956, a book came out called When Prophecy Fails. It was a social and psychological study of a modern group that predicted the destruction of the world. A couple of years before this, the authors of this book embedded themselves in a UFO cult in Chicago, Illinois. Do I have your attention yet? 1954, Dorothy Martin and one of her closest followers, Dr. Charles Lahey, they were running this cult in Chicago. They believed that in December of that year, a UFO was going to hover over the city and take them up with them. And so they believed, Dorothy was the one who ran it, Dorothy believed that it was going to happen on December 17th. And so this whole group of people in the UFO cult went out into the cold weather that night, and they waited for the UFO to come, And this is going to shock you, but it did not come. And then they went out the next night because they thought, well, I probably got it wrong by a day, and it still did not come. And then they went on the 21st, and it did not come. But she got word that night from the aliens that they would be coming back on Christmas Eve, which made a lot of sense, and everybody was excited about that. So they went out on Christmas Eve. There were only a handful of them at this point. It seems a few of them had decided maybe this wasn't real. And on Christmas Eve, they started to sing Christmas carols, and they believed that they would sing Christmas carols and remove all the metal from their pockets and all the metal from their persons. In fact, at one point during, this is a real story that was told in the book, at one point during the Christmas caroling, Dorothy asked one of the other ladies, like, isn't there metal in your bra strap? And she was like, yes, and she was like, take it off. And so she like went inside, removed the bra, came back out with a heavier coat, right? And that was, like, they were very, very serious about this. Now, again, I know this will surprise you. The aliens didn't show on the 24th either. And this is a picture of them coming back into the house. This is kind of the group all walking in. But there's also reporters that had gathered and some other people as well. Here's what's fascinating. Through the first, the second, the third time that these aliens didn't come, the UFOs didn't show up, most of the people in the group still believed it would happen, and most of them believed it even more than they had before. Because the pain of being so wrong was greater than the pain of saying, oh, we just got the wrong day. So they just doubled down. Why? Because your beliefs change when holding on to them becomes more painful than letting go. Some of you have been holding on to the belief that you can get it together and you can fix it for a very long time. If you were to write down the things that you know you struggle with the most right now, for many of you, they would be the exact same things that you struggled with 2 years ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago. I'm going to start the diet tomorrow. I'm going to stop being so angry with my kids. I'm going to start doing new things. I'm going to stop blaming other people. I'm going to stop being so defensive. I don't know what your particular things are, but I'll bet you do. And if you don't know, ask the people closest to you because they do know. For some of us, we've convinced ourselves for so long that we've got this. If we can just read the right self-help book, watch the right, you know, Brene Brown video, like we will get through this. We will figure it out. Only to find that we're really no further along today than we were a few years back. For some of us, we're convinced, like, oh, we just need to get into the right, you know, accountability group. We need to, like, join the right Facebook group. Or we need to find the right website or pay for the right. The world can help us. Maybe we can't do it. Maybe the world can help us, though. How long are you going to keep believing that and then being skeptical of the life that Jesus has offered you? Two shifts have to happen, and then we're done. This will be really fast. Here's the shift. This is from Tim Keller. He says this. In order for us to really connect with Jesus, we have to have a shift from wanting help from our suffering to wanting forgiveness for our sin. If you just think, like the reason that I would maybe pursue Jesus is because, like, I've got some things in my life that I don't like, and I just need to get them better and get them a little cleaned up, a little polished off. That's what Nicodemus thought when he came. And what Jesus told him is you need a whole, fresh, new start. And it's only when you start to recognize that you have brokenness and failure and fault in yourself, not to feel shame over them. You were created good. The God of this universe created you good. You are his son. You are his daughter. It's not about shame at all. It's about recognizing that there are some parts of us that are never going to be what they could be apart from God. We can't fix it. The world can't fix it. It's only God who can fix it. And in fact, it's that sin nature inside of us that we desperately need his forgiveness from that is the only pathway forward toward actually working through the help we need from the suffering we're going through. Secondly, we have to make the shift from earning salvation to resting in the free grace of God. And this is a harder shift than you would think that it is. Because for many of us, we recognize, like, I mean, if God were actually to deliver me from some of what I'm struggling with, if God were to actually deliver me from my faults, like, surely there's something I would owe him because I'm so deep in, or I'm so messed up, or I feel so lost, or so outside. If other people knew what I think, if other people knew what I did, they wouldn't want to have anything to do with me. I would have to do something heroic in order to make up for all that stuff. And what Jesus says is, believe. Believe that God loved the world so much that he sent his one and only son so that whoever would believe in him wouldn't keep walking down that path of destruction that ultimately leads to death, but instead would find eternal security in the goodness of the kingdom of God. Every week, just about, I say something like, hey, if you're not a follower of Jesus, if you haven't decided to put your trust in him yet, we are so glad that you're here, exploring, thinking about it. And every week that is true. Here's the other thing I need to follow that up with, though. If you're not a follower of Jesus, I believe God is grateful, thankful, excited that you're here or that you're watching online. But I also believe God loves you too much for you to stay in the place that you are. Some of you have been trying to figure this out your whole life. You've pursued money. You've pursued control. You've pursued power. It's not working. And at some point, perhaps the pain of that will be great enough that you'll choose to pursue something different, that you'll choose to perhaps put your trust in the one who came to take all of our brokenness upon himself. So here's what I'm going to ask you to do. All across the room, would you just bow your heads and close your eyes? Bow your heads, close your eyes. Nobody looking up here, just right where you are. I'm not going to ask you to stand. I'm not going to ask you to embarrass yourself. I'm not going to ask you to walk down an aisle today, anything like that. Here's the thing, though. I believe that as we're talking about belief, and belief specifically in the gospel that Jesus invites us to put our trust into, I believe that there are probably a number of us in here today who need to say, like, man, I've been on the bench. I've been thinking about this. I've been grappling with it. But I have not actually made the decision to put my trust in Jesus. And for some of you, I believe maybe today you're thinking, like, you need to make a real step toward that. So all I want to do is pray for you. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, if you're here today and you would say, like, Josh, I need to follow Jesus. I need to put my trust in him. Would you pray for me? I just want to pray for you. With every head bowed and every eye closed, if that's you, would you just slip your hand up and put it right back down so I can pray for you? Thank you. Yes, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you all over the room. Thank you. Yes, thank you so much. Thank you in the back. Thank you here. Anybody else? I just want to pray for you. I just want you to thank you so much. Thank you. Back there, I appreciate that. Thanks so much, my brother. Heavenly Father, probably 24 people in this room are willing to say, tired of trying to make it by myself, tired of trying to depend on the world to make it for me, Lord. I don't just need relief from my suffering, I need forgiveness from my sin. And Lord, you provide it. You provide forgiveness. It's who you are. You're a good God. And so I just pray for each hand that went up, and I pray for each hand that should have. And I ask, Lord, that you would give them courage to take a step forward today in their faith and their belief in you, Lord. And God, as they do that, I pray that they would have confidence that their sin is forgiven, but Lord, that also they would have confidence that their life can be different. As Emily read earlier about those of us who follow after your teachings and actually build our lives on the rock versus you know, maybe just raising a hand, but basically ignoring them the rest of the time and building our house on sand. Lord, may they build their house on rock. May we be sturdy and stable because you are sturdy and stable. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Look up here real fast. Look up here. Don't miss this. If you raise your hand today and you want to take the next step of belief, remember that Jesus said, those who are born of water and spirit. If you choose to put your trust in Jesus and you pray to him today to do that, like, then you're a follower of Christ. But the next thing you need to do is make a public declaration of your faith. And if you've never done that, I want to invite you to baptism. We have this QR code, which you can scan on your phone, or you can go to inlandhills.com/baptism. We are holding baptism services on November 20th. That's 3 Sundays from today. The week before that, on the 13th, we have a baptism class happening right here in this room, right after the service ends. We'll just gather together real fast and talk through what baptism means and what it is. But if you raise your hand today and you've never been baptized, I want to encourage you, implore you to consider baptism as your next step. If you really feel like, man, I need to put my faith, my trust in Jesus, like, that's your next step. And there will be more steps to follow. So some of you need to get baptized. Here's the thing. Some of you need to not get baptized because that's something you've already done, but some of you need to take more steps toward Jesus Christ. A lot of us just come on Sundays and it's like kind of a like feel good and it makes me feel better about my week and it's a good way to start the week. And that's like, that's a great starting place. But at some point in your life, you're going to have to decide if you're actually going to follow Jesus to the point of transformation or not. Because Jesus wants to transform you. But you have to agree to let him do it. And if you'll come here on most Sundays, and you'll start to serve, and you'll start to get involved in some group life at some point, then you will not be a different person probably in a week, but over the course of a couple years of doing that, you will look back and be shocked at the new person you've become. And so for some of you, you need to take that first step and get baptized. For some of you, though, you need to take the step and you need to get involved in a group life. You're new here. Maybe you haven't plugged in. You haven't connected. Or maybe you used to be in a group, but you're not anymore. Starting this Wednesday night, we are having TED Talks conversations. So we're just going to get together and talk about the message. You already heard it. Congratulations. All you have to do is talk about it now. And we're meeting here on campus. There is childcare if you want it. So you can go to our website, inlandhills.com/events. If you need childcare, you can sign up. If you don't need childcare, you don't even have to sign up. And we would love to have you here. inlandhills.com/events. You can get all the information for the TED Talks conversations that are happening starting this Wednesday. If you're not in a group, but you want to see your life increasingly transformed, really consider doing that. Now, before we leave today, I'm going to ask us to stand, and we're going to go to the Lord and worship one final time. Would you sing with us?